ocean. I'm going fishing for a girl out smoking with a man that ain't broken.
Kenny Arnoff, everyone's out there giving, we call it a virtual round of applause.
Awesome.
Here at Drumeo. So
applause back to you. So I want to give kudos to the guy who wrote that song.
Yeah.
So the two songs I just played are a guy called Phil X, who's in a band called The Drills. He's Canadian, and he wrote these two songs, and I play with them sometimes, and I wanted to give him a yo. And right now he's on tour with Bon Jovi, which is pretty cool. He's a guitar player. Anyway, I'm here playing this amazing Yamaha DTX electronic drum kit. And a lot of people say, wow, Kenny, the acoustic drummer playing electronic drums. Yeah. And it fell into it by accident. Well, now let me first say, though, I always supplemented from 1986. I started supplementing my acoustic kit with John Mellencamp. With triggers and sounds from our records, because I had this drum sound that I became well known for off the Scarecrow album with Mellencamp, and I kept thinking, God, I wish I could have that exact sound live, because the drums were so prominent. And somebody said, well, you can. And there was another company that made electronic drums called D-Drum out of Sweden, and somebody hooked me up with You got the samples from recording. Back then it was 2-inch tape, and got them into these chips and put them in a D-drum, and we triggered my sounds live. I was pretty lame with understanding electronics back then, so it was double triggers, and John would turn around, "What are you doing?" I'm like, "It's not me, it's the triggers." And, you know, John was like, "I don't care what it is, it sounds like crap." Anyway, so that was my introduction. And then, you know, different things, you know, if I needed a certain sound, a break drum off of a Scarecrow sound, if, you know, I might put that on a pad. So I kind of, you know, so I've been using electronics. And then with Melissa Etheridge, I used to have loops I'd run off of a pad. I'd have different sounds. And I think with Fogerty once on tour, he wanted to have this modern sound for Down on the Corner. So I had, in my acoustic kit, I had integrated a kick drum pad and a snare pad and a hi-hat pad. I was doing kind of a hip-hop groove, you know, for Down on the Corner. So I've always had electronics in my kit. I'm just known as the acoustic guy. Mm-hmm. What happened with DTX was I was doing Zildjian wanted me to come do a sampling thing for the Gen 16 electronic cymbal. And I thought, cool, you know, I thought that was amazing that an acoustic, famous acoustic cymbal company, the biggest in the world, was suddenly wanting to do an electronic cymbal to go with kits, you know. And they wanted to sample guys like me to get our sounds and our grooves and put the library of the Zildjian cymbals on the cymbals and add it to our grooves. Anyway, long story short, I show up in between sessions and, you know, touring and this and that. I'm like, I walk in. I didn't know what I was walking into. And I see this kit, and I'm like, what is this? And I start playing it. And the feel of the pads, I'd never felt anything like this. Yeah. You know, there was other companies, without mentioning them, that had, you know, the springboard thing, you know, like a trampoline bouncing off. This was the best feeling kit I've ever played. And I was blown away. And that's what got me hooked. I said, I got to have a kit of this. And, you know, I have to tell you, the way I'm using this kit, I do have like a pad on tour with Fogerty for the hand claps on center field. And it's a certain sound that John is very particular about. So I trigger it with a pad. I also have a trigger on my kick drum because I have four sources of sounds for my kick drum. One is I have a 16-channel mixer live. And one channel is the acoustic kick, and the other channel is the sample. I have a trigger on my kick drum. It goes to a sample that's in the DTX, makes a multi-pad, and I have a sample in that, and it triggers that, and I can blend those. The third source is I have a Porter & Davis makes this thing called it's like a butt kicker.
Yeah,
basically,
I tried that.
Yeah, the Porter & Davis is amazing. Basically, what it is the trigger then goes to an amplifier that then goes to this speaker that is in my stool, which
it's
gives
awesome.
Me a, it's awesome. Oh, gives you a bolt. Awesome. Except when I do double bass drum real fast, it makes it go, ah! I basically kill it. You know, it's like I'm Kryptonite and Superman goes down. So maybe I'm Superman, I kill Kryptonite. That's it.
Come on, definitely. Peel back.
I'm a superhero. So then the fourth source of sound is a big monitor behind me. Yeah. So, I mean, kick drum is the hardest to hear live, and so that's why I have four sources. The bottom line is this is how I integrate the electronic drum kit in my life. Now, another aspect of the electronic drum kit, which has become huge, is I have a house in Studio City in L.A., and I have a studio about 6 miles away. Yeah. I have the studio that, if you go on a website, it's Uncommon Studios with an S, LA.com. www.uncommonstudiosla.com, and you see everything about my studio, and people send me files, and I record, songs for your records, and also people come to my studio to record my drums there, and I've got all
my... You produce as well, right?
Yeah, I produce too. I've produced a few little things in my studio, but when I produced an artist, Matt Gold, and we did it at a Dave Bianco studio, which is a bigger studio, you know.
Cool.
But what I do is in this house I have, I don't have my studio in the house, so I have a room, I have a big-ass three-car garage, and in that three-car garage I created a little room where I have my DTX kit. And the beauty of that is I can practice 24 hours a day. So I've gotten really spoiled where I'm on this kit a lot for practicing. It's incredible to work out. I mean, I'm I'm known as the chart man. You know, I get calls to, can you see that? Here, this might be better.
Yeah, that little camera, there you go.
That could take me about 45 minutes to write.
Yeah.
That's a song I'm going to do with another Canadian artist.
And that's all, you guys can download that below, right?
Right.
Yeah, just so you guys are here, there's a link below. It says download the PDFs, and you can, it's crazy to look at.
Here's an example. I've got file cabinets of charts. Like, for example, if I got a call to do with Joe Cocker, like, we need you tomorrow. I've got a file of all the Joe Cocker charts that I've done from touring. I have the Pumpkins charts. I have the Bob Seger charts. I have Fogarty's like this. And the other day, I was going to do a drum clinic for DTX, and I get a call from the Bodine saying, Kenny, what are you doing? I said, I'm going to a clinic. Is there any way you can come to San Francisco now to do a show? And I went, no, I'm on my way to do a clinic. And then I had to, after the clinic, I raced back to LA, and they had promoted that I was going to sit in with this Moby Dick's Led Zeppelin tribute band. So I did Stairway to Heaven, Black Dog. I raced back to my house, unloaded my drums, kissed my wife, say, Gina, I got to write charts. And so from 1:30 to 3, 1:30 to 3:30, I wrote 4 Bodine's charts. Meanwhile, they had been emailing me because I'm going to play with them for the rest of the week.
Yeah.
So, in other words, so Saturday night, I'm starting Sunday. And so I wake up the next morning from 9 to 1 o'clock, I write the other 13. So I had 17 charts written out, and this allows me to, and I have the tempos. And when I write a chart, I mean, I write every note out because they sent me their live arrangements. So I don't know if, I figure that's what they're doing. They're used to hearing those live arrangements, those parts. I always start with that first. And I grabbed my chicken foot kit because I got like 8 kits out there right now that I'm using.
Yeah.
You know, 2 for Fogarty, this touring kit, 1 in my house like that. That's 4, well, a whole bunch in my studio. Then 1 in my garage for live stuff I play on Monday nights with this heavy metal band. And then another kit for, 2 kits for sessions. 1 right now is going to a movie set where I'm doing,
with the stories you have. You're in an Al Pacino movie?
I'm in an Al Pacino movie.
Named Imagine.
It's now like hashtag session drummer, hashtag touring drummer, hashtag producer, hashtag actor.
Yeah.
I'm going to be doing an Al Pacino movie. It's about a guy. The movie's called Imagine. And Al Pacino is an amazing human being. So friendly and so nice.
Yeah.
He goes, you guys. You guys, like it's Godfather talk. You guys are great. I love you musicians. You guys. Like, wow.
That's crazy.
Anyway, so he, so we're in his band. Anyway, long and short of it, back to the charts. The charts allow me to go show up. We only had time to rehearse 1.5 songs, and so I basically sight reading.
Yeah.
And you'll see 1 song today. I'm going to sight read another Canadian artist.
So for a full gig of 13, 15 songs, you'll only rehearse 1 or 1.5 with the
band? Well, we only rehearsed 1.5. That was 17 songs. So what I did was I keep my eye on the leader. I went in the dressing room. We went over everything for about 2 hours.
Wow.
And sure enough, the charts were wrong because they had changed the arrangements. So I'm rewriting and sight reading.
Wow.
And that's the only way I can't memorize that fast.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, I've got 20 songs I have to learn for a show in Dallas on the 17th, and I have 1 rehearsal. So I'll write all that out. I've got 3 new songs to learn for the Bodines coming up in about 8 days. I've got other songs and other material. I mean, just constantly writing.
So you have to know how to read.
I have to
chart.
Well, I mean, in order to do certain situations, you do have to be able to read. Like I do the Kennedy Center Honors every year, which means in one show, I could be playing with 14 artists. Like 7, let's say we were honoring, when we honored Paul McCartney, it was like Steven Tyler, Dave Grohl, and then 5 other people.
Yeah.
And then I was also honoring maybe Merle Haggard. So I had 7 country songs to learn. You're changing things at the last minute, like an hour before you go on. And I have to count off everything or know who to give the tempo to, when to count off, what the count off is. This is a live show. You got the President of the United States there, plus all these famous actors. It's a high-pressure gig. There's no way I could possibly remember all that if I couldn't read. You have to be able to read to do a show like that.
Yeah.
Or when I did the inauguration, I'm playing with 27 artists, and it's cold, and there's tempos, and you're playing with Beyonce, and then you're playing with Josh Groban, and you're playing with Mellencamp, James Taylor, playing with Stevie Wonder, Garth Brooks, it's all over the map. And you have to understand so much, and there's no way to memorize all that in a short period of time.
Yeah.
You're rehearsing with those famous artists day of the show, and it's going all over the world. I mean, I have to be able to read. I wouldn't trust myself to memorize.
Yeah, that's insane.
I can't remember my name. Was it Aronoff, Kenneth? Kenneth, David, Aronoff, something.
Hey, can I just say a few things about you before you go on? Because I just want to make sure I let some people know about where they can continue to follow you and stuff
sure,
like that.
Sure, absolutely.
So all the stuff he's talking about here, all the artists he's played with, you know, at Drumeo, we're just so extremely lucky and thankful to have you here. Literally, you're a living legend, man. And you're going to
And I'm going to live a long time. the legends may live longer than Earth. I'm just joking.
So you've heard about some of the people he's played for. I don't think I've read a longer list of credentials before. So it's
I'm fortunate to have that list. But it's going to be almost impossible to get that list ever again because the way the music business has changed.
Yeah.
There were so many budgets. People would fly me in for one song. And I'd be Santana this day, Bob Dylan next day, Elton John the next day. It's unfortunate, man.
I have some questions about that I'd love to ask you. And I know there's so many people watching here that are going to have questions too. You broke the chat. We have a chat system going, and there's too many simultaneous requests.
Love it. Thank you.
So in order to ask a question, you have to use the submit a question box below. There's already a bunch coming in. And so, I just want to let you continue talking, but I wanted to mention that kind of stuff. And so today's lesson is kind of on functional practicing and a bunch of other kind of cool tips and concepts that you had.
Yeah.
So.
Well, you want me to start teaching some of this stuff?
Yeah, I think it'd be great.
Okay.
What you're doing is great. The charting stuff. I love hanging out with that kind of
there's
stuff.
There's not enough time to do everything. And that kind of ties into what my whole approach is to myself and then teaching other people. And there's this thing I call functional practicing. And basically what that is if you're going to practice, you get right down to the business that's going to make you sound good today, right now. Don't practice things for the future until you take care of business because you're being judged by how you play today. So I created these routines that help me sound great right now. And so, for example, and functional means you're also trying to accomplish as much as you can all at once. That makes sense, you know. So obviously, if you're going to warm up, and I'll do this on the DTX, and this is the beauty of this module here. It's got a click track built in. It's got songs you can play to. Even if the songs are corny, you can work out a lot of stuff. But let's just start with the click track, with a click. And you know, basically, I have three videos, well, two DVDs now. They took the three videos and made two DVDs. One is called The Basics of Rock Drumming, and then the other is two power workouts. Basically, it's 10 lessons on one workout and 10 on the other, and they're combined. You got 20 lessons. And they're built on, all these DVDs are built on 13 hand patterns, which I think are very functional, and I'll explain them. And you'll be able to download these hand patterns.
Yeah, right below the video. You guys can download.
What it is that we all have to play single strokes to get around, especially in rock and roll. So the first two lines of these hand patterns are, and this is, by the way, is based off of a very famous book called Stick Control, except I reverse lines 11 and 12, so you don't have seven consecutive rights in a row. But the first two lines are this single stroke. Right, left, right, left, right, left. And that's the first line. The second line is starting with your left hand. Left, right, left, right, left, right. This way you can balance and become as ambidextrous as you can. Because, you know, sometimes you'll see me, I'll be playing this way, I'll be playing this way. You want to be totally ambidextrous. Anyway, the second line and third line and fourth line is the second most important stroke in drumming, which are double strokes. Get the double stroke rolling, and you know, you'll be doing like, that's a double stroke. That's a double. the second, third line. So the third line is right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left. Fourth line is left, left, right, right, left, left, right, right. The fifth line is a famous rudiment called the paradiddle. By the way, the single stroke and the double stroke are rudiments in drumming, and which are your primary, it's like your alphabet in English. So the fifth line is a summation of lines 1, 2, 3, and 4. And ironically, it is one of the most famous rudiments called the paradiddle. So the paradiddle is a right, left, which is line 1, the beginning of line 1, right, right, which is the beginning of line 3, left, right, which is the beginning of line 2, and left, left is the beginning of line 4. So you've got right, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left. Summation of lines 1 through 4. And the beauty of this rudiment and is to integrate two different techniques together. Single strokes, when I was studying classical music, when you played marimba, it was all single strokes. The yarn mallet would hit a wood bar and it wouldn't bounce. So it would be, my teacher taught me to lift, lift, lift. So I'll demonstrate that right now. No fingers. It's all wrist. The double stroke, you have to use a different technique, which is one stroke down with your wrist, and then you let your fingers get out of the way of the stick and let it naturally bounce off the drum like this. And then the second stroke, you use your fingers to throw it back down. You get two strokes. One wrist, two strokes. One wrist, two strokes. Singles, doubles. Singles, doubles. So the paradiddle integrates both of those. Singles, right, left, doubles, right, right. Singles, left, right. Left, left is doubles. Great exercise is to go singles, doubles, paradiddle. Single, double, paradiddle. Singles. So you can hear the difference. Singles, doubles, paradiddle. Singles, doubles, paradiddle. Singles, doubles, paradiddle. Okay? Now, we progress. Lines 6, 7, and 8 are variations of the paradiddle. So you have right, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left. And then line 7 is right, right, left, right, left, left, right, left. I know it's a little confusing, but when you look at it, you'll see the doubles just keep getting moved around. Mm-hmm. And finally, line 8 is right, left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, right. And these are all combinations of the first four lines. Now we get into line 9, 10, 11, 12, and now it's combinations of three strokes, like right, 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 left, right, right. You ask yourself, when do I ever use three strokes? So sometimes you do. When you're doing jazz, you do. Or Latin. So it's there, or, let's see. It's a pretty valid thing to have. So line 9 is right, 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 left. Line 10 is left, 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 right. Line 11 is left, right, right, right. And line 12 is right, left, left, left. And finally, you get to line 13, which I throw in there just to make it tough. And that's four strokes in a row. One, two, three, four, one. So here's the 13 lines. I'll put my right hand on the tom-tom so you can hear the different patterns. So it's one, two, three,
awesome, man.
Now, it's amazing, but now this is just the beginning. Okay. Now we're going to get into functional practicing where now when you play the drums, you use your feet with your hands. So, like, there's no way I'm going to leave my feet out. So I've designed, on my videos, I think I have 6 or 7 foot patterns. But I'm going to give you just 3 today. One pattern is while you're playing these, let's call this 8th notes with your hands. And for you those that don't know the difference, the 8th note is twice as many notes per quarter note. Mm-hmm. So if this is a quarter note, this is 8th note. It's twice as many. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So I'm going to play quarter notes with my right foot while I do this. Then I go through all 13 lines and I go right into the same thing again, 13 lines, with my left foot. And then the last pattern is my feet. Both my feet play 8th notes. It's a double bass drum exercise. And the reason why I picked the double bass drum foot is because I'm always trying to develop that. So I try functional practicing, trying to accomplish as much as I can in a short period of time. So I, this is not my strength. I'm pretty good at it, but it's not as, I'm not as good with my feet as my hands. So I've included that as a sticking pattern to go with my feet, to go with this exercise. Trying to accomplish as much as possible. So here I'll give you a quick version of this. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Okay, so you can see when one of the hardest ones is to go from line 1 to line 2 with your feet because you're playing right, left, right, left, right, left, and your feet are going right, left, right, left, right, left, and all of a sudden you shift to left, right with your hands, and your hands don't want to do that. They want to stay right with the right hand with the right foot. So this is what I'm talking about. Concentrate on left with right, so your brain is going this way. Anyway, so now you can do functional practicing again. I believe you need to be able to play with your heels down and your heels up. So I would go through all these patterns, what you just saw, with my heels down, then do the whole system again with my heels up. Heels up, there's a beater into the head that gets one sound, and heels down, the beater comes off the head. I need both those techniques every day for my playing, so I warm up with that. Now, this progresses into, and we don't have enough time to do it all. This progresses into a single stroke roll, because you need to be able to do this. So I created an exercise that goes with that. You take, let's say, every line that you do, like right, left, right, left, right, left, call that 8th notes. Now we're going to double that note value with 16th notes and do a single stroke roll. The best way is to demonstrate it. So you got right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left. By the way, the single stroke rolls are either start with the right hand or start with the left hand. Any line that ends with a left sticking, you start the roll with the right sticking. So the first line is right, left, right, left, right, left. The roll now is with the right hand. Second line, left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right. Now the roll starts with the left hand. And it's easier if you're right-handed to do a roll with the right hand, and then if you're left-handed, it's easier to start with the left hand. Okay. So let me demonstrate. I'll do the rolls on the snare drum, but I'll do the patterns here so you can hear. Line 1. And you include your feet. and so on. And then you can do the same exercise where instead of doing a single stroke roll, you do a double roll, double stroke roll. Gone further when I have time, you do a paradiddle roll. So it'd be like line one. Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
Now there's a lot more I do, but another big significant thing with me is I got, you know, double bass drum, even though I don't use it all the time. I have an exercise for that because the next thing is to warm up my double pedal technique and my single bass drum technique. And the way I do my single bass drum technique is pretty simple. I just set up a click. Let's say if I use my DTX and I set up a click, let's say I'll just use, I'll pick a number, let's say like 120, and I'll use the click. Let's see if you can hear this. Okay, I'll play 16th with my feet, and there are, I'll play eighth notes on my ride cymbal, 16th notes with my feet. Okay. And there'll be four different hand patterns I'm going to do. First one's going to be one, two, and on four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Second one's going to be one, two, three, four. Four is... one, two, three, and four with the left hand. And the third one's gonna be all offbeats. One, and two, and three, and four, and one. And the fourth one is one, a two, and three, and four, one, two. I pick these patterns because I use them when I play. Mm-hmm. I mean, once again, functional practicing. Practice what things you will be using to make you sound good today. So, and each series, I count to 25 measures. I'll just give you an example. Then you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You get to 25, you go to the fourth pattern. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then if I really got time, I'd do the whole thing leading with my left hand. The same, all of that I just did. And it's a great stamina thing for your feet and to develop your double bass drumming. So when you need it, you've got it. And I've got a perfect system to practice that. If I have time, I'll do the whole system with my heels down and my heels up.
Oh, okay.
But a lot of times I don't have time to practice. So if I only have 20 minutes of practice, I address all of this very quickly and I trim it down. But it definitely warms you up. Now, the single, and then we'll move on to some other songs, but okay. The single bass drum exercise I have is basically, it's based on this pattern here. You're playing all the eighth notes except for the two and four, and it's a great exercise that helps me warm up my feet, you know. And I'll play quarter notes on the hi-hat and then eighth notes. So it'll be like. And then I will reverse, put the snare drum on one and three. And I've created all kinds of exercises based on that.
Wow.
You know, I'll do like what I call a groove fill, which is you're still grooving. You're using the hi-hat, kick drum, and snare drum, but you're using multiple beats with your feet. So you got like. Groove fill I was doing was I kept the quarter notes going here, but I was going one. Basically, you're going one snare, two kick, and it starts to be like a three against four.
Yeah, polyrhythm.
Yeah. And then I got into fives. One, two, one.
Well, you just gave everyone enough stuff to practice.
I know, man. You guys, I charge a lot per lesson, so you guys should be sending me tons of money.
And so this is off of your power workout, some stuff on the power
workout. Some of the stuff, the double bass was not on the workout, okay. But a lot of this stuff is on my power workout, the hand patterns. And I talk about, I mean, I'm sure we're running out of time. Talk about the four concepts of drumming, which I'll just... You can get that on the basics of rock drumming. And the four concepts of drumming is this. I don't care what style of music you're doing, but if you're not doing this, you're not going to be working. Mm-hmm. I mean, I broke it down when I started to make it, and I said, why am I working so much? And the question is, if I hand you a pair of sticks and I want you to play music in my band, what am I looking for? First and most foremost, most important thing, what am I looking for? And what I'm looking for is I want you to play the perfect beat for my song. If you change the beat, you change the song. Mm-hmm. All those hit songs I played on, you know, with Mellencamp and some, and you know, Bon Jovi, Blaze of Glory, and a bunch of other ones, Meatloaf, I came up with a beat. Mm-hmm. And they worked with John. He used to play his songs on acoustic guitar and then say, Kenny, give me a beat. So it might be a simple beat, but it made those songs, it affected how everybody else played.
Yeah, you made the right musical choice.
Right musical choice, exactly, that made the bass player play a certain way. I won't get into details because I got a lot of stories where I changed one eighth note, made the bass player think, oh, that sounds like the Stones Meet the Police. And so he changed his bass line because he musically was influenced by the musical decision I made on the drum kit. Yeah. So it wasn't a complicated technical thing, it was a musical choice. And that's somebody might say, well, you know, Kenny has no technique, but technique isn't just chops, it's musical ideas and knowing when to do something, how to do something, how much to open your hi-hat. I focus so much on my hi-hat all the time to blend, to make this kit sound amazing. And where I place my kick drum and snare drum to that hi-hat is the musical genius of that sound. Yeah. And how that affects the other musicians. You know, I've had people like Sammy Hagar turn around and go like, what are you doing?
Yeah, what's different?
What's different?
And that's my question I always ask. Like,
it's undefinable, but it's musical. It's not technical in terms of chops. It's musical technique.
Yeah.
So the most important thing is to pick the right beat for the song. The next thing is the first two beats you play define tempo. So if you go one, two, three, four, one, the distance between this beat and this is a measurement of time. Mm-hmm. And if you repeat that, it's steady. And that's good, solid tempo. Now, some songs, it's good to speed up. But you need to have control and be aware of tempo. When John Fogerty starts a song like Green River, boom, da-da-da-da, da-da-da, I'm doing this, da-da-da-da. So when I come in, da da da. So when I come in, it's exactly where he's at. And then I listen to him and try to line this hi-hat up with his guitar.
Yeah.
And put it in that spot that makes the whole thing sound great. Mm-hmm. But it's not like I'm just dreaming about, oh, this is easy to play and I'm just thinking about something else. I concentrate every time I play on making my my beat, my time, and thirdly, the groove, the feel. Make that band sound better. And if you do that day in and day out, people want to hire you. The groove is the combination of everything I'm doing on my drum kit, how much I open a hi-hat, how hard I hit the snare, where I place the snare against the hi-hat, the kick drum, everything about my sound. But there's another groove, and that is there's all these limbs, four limbs, but you're one limb as a drummer to the band. So if it's a four-piece band, you are one of four things making the sound of the band.
Yeah.
So there's that groove, how you place everything you're doing in the band. And I'm thinking about this all the time. Yeah. Every song, every situation, always. Doesn't matter if I'm in a club or if I'm in front of a million people. Yeah. Or even right now, I'm thinking groove, time, beat. And the fourth and the final thing in my four steps of, you know, the basics of being a great drummer is creative ideas that you add to that foundation of beat, time, and groove. It's like you can't decorate a cake with icing until you make the cake. The cake is essential. The icing is extra. It makes you attracted to look at that cake and want to eat it. But without the cake, the icing is useless. Yeah. And you need to have that foundation. So if you got simple like that, right? That was a creative idea. Creative idea. Creative idea. Creative idea in the kick drum. Tom.
Kind of, it's a simple concept, and I always tell our members, take notes. That's something I would like. I'm going to rewatch this video and take notes and write all those four concepts down.
There's so much to learn.
Yeah.
I will never be as great as I want to be,
but
I'm willing to spend the rest of my life trying to be as great as I can be.
Cool.
And once I accepted that, I accepted that I was a human and not a machine, and that, you know, it's some people get freaked out when they realize, well, I'll never be that good. Well, that's just life. You will never be as great as your brain wants to be.
Yeah.
It's accepting, when you can accept that you will try as hard as you can at whatever. It could be just parenting. It could be cooking. It could be cleaning. It could be anything. It doesn't have to be something famous. I happen to be a drummer. Whatever you're doing to be the best that you can be, knowing you'll never get maybe as far as you want, but still willing to be the best you can be, it's the human condition. And and you should admire yourself for making progress at whatever you're doing. It doesn't matter if it's, doesn't have to be things that the whole world knows. Just you and you know. You know, people who tell me, they, like a simple person said, God, I can't do cardio. I can't do cardio. And here I can whip off an hour on cardio. You know, my wife and I work out all the time. And I just told this person, why don't you just walk for 5 minutes every day? Just 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. Walk for 1 week. Next week, I want you to walk for 10 minutes every day. And the third week, 15 minutes. And the fourth week, 20 minutes. And you keep going till you're up to an hour. Then I want you to do 5 minutes of running, jogging. The first, the next week, whatever week, and then try 10 minutes. And it's a progress, simple little progress. And you feel, start to feel, all of a sudden, you can jog for a half hour and run fast for a half hour. It's mm-hmm. it's a progression. And don't be overwhelmed that you have to be up there. Yeah. And if you feel integrity about making these steps, and don't worry about what other people are thinking. I know we all heard that when we were kids. Don't worry about what the kids say. Well, you of course you worry. But finally, when you can be free of that, you just keep your eyes focused on what you're doing in life. And you're going to have adversity and people messing with you. Stay focused and keep going forward. Keep your legs moving, your head forward, and just go forward no matter what anybody does. If someone tries to stop you, push them out of the way and keep going. Mm-hmm. That's how you get through life.
Cool.
It's like a football player. If he stopped every time somebody tried to tackle him, say, hey, man, that hurt. He's going to get hit by somebody else. Yeah. So the idea is like, that hurt, but he keeps looking at the end zone and pushing forward for like 17 years.
Yeah.
And then when he's done, he sees where he's at. I mean,
it's come a long way.
Yeah.
Cool. Do you have another song that you wanted to
play? Yeah. Okay.
I'm going to take some questions. So this is the time, you guys, if you have questions, put them below. There's already tons, and I've marked a few that I want to get to. But
cool.
Well, I'll do my best.
All right, this song is also a Canadian artist. His name's Philip Sace. The other was Phil X. I'm in the Phil zone here. This is called Powerful Thing, and I recorded this song with him. It's cool. Here we go.
Love!
Great song. Who is that again?
That's Philip Sayce, S-A-Y-C-E. That's called Powerful Thing off of a Peace Machine. I think it's Peace Machine. And we recorded that with no rehearsals. We did, I think, the whole album, 13 songs in a day and a half.
Wow.
That was live, no edits. Because we, Philip's guitar amp was right next to me, and we just, everything bled it. He wanted that live thing. So my sound went into his mics, his sound went into my mics, so there was no edits.
Wow.
For 13 songs.
Love it.
You know what I love is this, like, you can muffle these cymbals.
That's cool.
Isn't that wild? How'd they do that?
I have two kids at home, and this is like what I practice on all the time, because the kids are sleeping bad.
I mean, it's bizarre. It's incredible. It's a great tool.
Yeah.
There's, you know, the sensitivity on these. You guys, you can change the pitches. Yeah. You know, it's the sensitivity underneath, so you can make it more sensitive, less sensitive.
Yeah, they're great drums. I always try and get it right. It's a textured cellular silicone. That's the technology.
Is that what this is?
Yeah, it's the technology they use there.
Yeah,
it makes it feel so.
And good. Did you know that like the snares are thicker? They got, it's more compressed and harder, and they made the toms a little rubbier.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, because snare heads are usually tighter than the.
Yeah.
You know.
Cool. Okay, we have a lot of questions, and but since you're here, I'm gonna be a little selfish, and I have one of my own.
Sure.
If that's right. The first time I ever saw you play, I used to be really into watching like late night TV when my parents let me stay up that late. And so I think I saw you play on Letterman. I forget the artist. I was trying to find it on YouTube because you've done it so many times now.
Was I with the artist or was I in the band?
You're in the
house band.
Yeah. Well,
sometimes I played in the house band.
I know sometimes you played in the house band, but I think it was an artist. Like, I found the one you played with Colin James. I think that was in like 1990.
Oh, wow.
Long time ago. I couldn't find the one I was looking for, though. But I just wanted to ask, what is it like going to playing in one of those late night shows? What's the vibe? And
oh, well, it's really exciting. They're all different. Letterman is...
Oh,
my belt pack just came off. Letterman is... first of all, the famous thing about Letterman is he keeps the room at like 48 degrees. It's freezing.
Really?
Yeah. Keeps the audience awake. He just likes it. I mean, keeps it crisp. And I'll tell you, the most scary time doing a late night show for me was when I did Saturday Night Live once, first time. Mm-hmm. I've done it four times. And it was with Mellencamp, and we had two big hits. It was like, I think Hurt So Good and Jack and Diane. We were at the top of the charts. We were the happening. And we're on the set, and I'm thinking, oh my God, it's live, it's live, it's live, all over the world. Live, don't mess up. And you know, I'm all nervous. And they put you on a set, you know, and they've gone to commercial or they have different like little places where you do skits, maybe in this area, then this area, another one, in this area. There might be three of them or four. And we're getting set up in the musical area. And they go to commercial, and we're checking our sound, and oh my God, it was like 2 minutes before air. I'm like, oh my God, my everyone's watching. I mean, I'm just a kid back then. All of a sudden, somebody, lady comes running through the audience and comes up. She's coming to stage, and I'm like, oh no, she's coming to me. She comes up to me and powders my head because it's shining. It's like you've been seeing today. I am so embarrassed, and I'm so nervous because I'm trying to, and the band's laughing, the audience is laughing. If that happened to me right now, I would think it was hilarious. I'd get up and start dancing, and I'd be going, yeah, man, I'd powder my head. But back then, I was like, serious, you know, I'm on Saturday Night Live.
Yeah.
So I was freaking. And so that was always the scariest. Letterman, the first time I played with Letterman, I was really nervous because when I played not with a band, but in the band, mm-hmm. and there's all these cues, and Paul sent me like 300-400 songs to learn, and I said, Paul, man, there's no way I'm going to learn 400 songs. I was flying and typically from Japan. I was doing something else. So we narrowed down to 30 songs. And I got all my notes, and you have to learn the theme. And they start the theme in different places before they even go on air. It's a whole bunch of stuff. And then at rehearsal, you only have a half hour, and you've got this cue sheets. And it's like, okay, we have to have music that brings people on and gets them off.
Yeah.
And they just come up with it right there. They'll go like, we got a comedian called something Stilson. And Paul goes, Stilson. Ah, Crosby, Stills, Nash. All right, let's do Judy Sweet Blue Eyes. Because I'll go with Stilson, you know, Stilson. And we go, okay, Will, you start. No. Okay, you do. Yeah, and then you, Kenny, you come in here and you go, okay, 3, 4. Okay, let's try one more time. All right, next song.
Yeah.
And you got, I write down, he counts off, Judy Sweet Plus, next song, you know, and you just whip through these songs. Yeah. And so we're there, we do the theme, everything's going great. We warm up the audience before I come in. I've got that, I'm like jet lagged from Japan, and I'm looking at my notes and I see the thing. And we bring a guy out to do a stupid human tricks. And we bring the music on. Okay, I'm get throw that piece of paper, get ready for the next thing. And he's talking, all of a sudden, Dave says, no, I don't do that. Anton, come up here. Oh, Anton's not here. Kenny, come on up here. Me? Says, Kenny, come on up here. Live. I go right up to center stage. I've got to tie a yo-yo on a guy's foot while he does a handstand. And I'm like, okay. Dave says, I don't do that. So he says, okay, buddy, tie it on. He goes up, and he's waddling. Dave's going, get the yo-yo on his foot. So probably got to get the commercial. I'm like, I'm trying to follow the guy. His foot's going. I finally get it on. He says, well, go back and give me a snare roll. I go back. I mean, it was insane. It was
that
like,
is crazy. Ah!
And, but when you, to more directly to answer your question, it's very exciting. I'm very comfortable at these places.
Yeah.
Leno is, that's a little more, seems a little bit, I don't know, it seems a little bit more relaxed. But in general, it's the excitement that you're doing TV, and it's going to be on all night, you know, that night. You don't want to mess up. You want to look casual. You want to be comfortable. At this point in my game, I'm so comfortable on TV. It's I know all the cameramen on all the shows. Yeah. I know the musical. I know everybody. So it's like, yo, what's happening? And, you know, yeah.
That's cool.
It's
man.
Pretty. It's right. Exciting.
Yeah. Okay. Another question. Kaltel Bot 01 says, hey Kenny, that was freaking awesome. He says he's been playing e-kits for the past 12 years, and this week he's playing a gig where an acoustic kit is provided, and he's unsure. Should I use the acoustic kit, or will it throw me off?
Well, there's always an adjustment from the electronic kit to acoustic. The biggest adjustment for me is the bass drum pedal.
Okay.
Because on an acoustic kit, the pedal will go forward more by the time it hits the head. That's the biggest transition for me. If I'm playing electronic kit, go to acoustic kit, is an adjustment with that. I will always pick acoustic over electronic because I just love all the nuances you can get from electronic, from the acoustic kit. Mm-hmm. And it's got more instant expression, especially the cymbals. So I personally vote for acoustic kit always if you can.
Yeah. Cool. This is from Captain John. He says, on John Bon Jovi's Blaze of Glory, what bell did you use? And on the bridge, what snare rudiments did you use?
Oh, interesting about the bridge. All right, you know what, dude? It's a good question. There was this part of Blaze of Glory, we did a march. And because I've had classical training, I basically did, I think, 4 to 6 snare drums, all tuned at different pitches. And I wrote a drum line. You know, I wrote a snare drum roll. First I recorded it, the main snare, with kick drum, because I had, it starts off with snare drum, it says, you know, and then, kick drum. Then I overdubbed like 5 or 3 more snare drums tuned high, low, medium to get that thing. And it's basically 9 stroke rolls, 5 stroke rolls, and 7 stroke rolls.
Cool.
And so that's what I did. The bell, I can't remember what ride symbol I was using back then. I'm sorry, I can't remember. It might have been a rock ride. And the reason why I like the Zildjian rock ride, it had a big bell.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was...
He says he's glad to have met you in Fresno at Bentley's and the Avalon.
Absolutely, man. Avalon was probably with Chicken Foot, and Bentley's was a drum clinic.
Yeah. This one might be a hard one from Mr. Mustache. He says, who is your favorite artist band you've ever played with?
That is a tough one.
Yeah.
I can't, there is no favorite artist. There's too many. You know, there's so many great ones I've played with that are fantastic. You know, the tours. I have to say, one of the most... I'd probably say the greatest tour, although that's a scary one to say because it was, all of them are great. Mm-hmm. But the Chicken Foot tour was extraordinary because the musicianship was so high level And everybody at this point in their life is so happy that it was such a everybody was getting along. And we were having a blast. And we were traveling private jets, staying at the best hotels. And it was short so that nothing could go wrong.
Yeah.
It was just amazing. But the musicianship was extraordinary.
Awesome.
I felt like I was in Led Zeppelin and Van Halen all in one.
It's a pretty good feeling. I mean,
really? I'm going to get better on that.
Yeah. This one's from R. Kid. He says, how do you juggle your time and actually have time to practice? He said, your workload is incredible.
No, he's right. It's very difficult to practice. The hardest things that are challenged, things that I'm challenged with is which I got pretty much down, is the eating part. I've learned how to eat properly.
Yeah.
But when you're working so much, the next hard thing is exercise, the type of exercise I like, which is lifting weights to keep muscle tone up. I'm down right now about 8 pounds.
Wow.
I'm very, I'm muscular, but it's not what it usually is.
You look like you're in pretty good shape to me.
Yeah,
look at these twigs.
this is, to me, is a little flat in here. But anyway, you can see my shoulders are a little, they're not out as much. I know it sounds funny, but I'm into keeping muscular tone because, when you lift weights and it keeps your hormone levels up, and hormone levels up fight all diseases. So anyway, that's a challenge. The other challenge is spending enough time with my gorgeous wife, which I adore, and I wish I could have her with me, but she doesn't like to travel with me because it's no fun for her. So if she's still watching, she's probably not even watching anymore. She's probably like, I'm sick, I've seen you drum. But, that's kind of a challenge, and there's nothing you can do about that. And the practicing thing is brutal. Mm-hmm. I have a pad in my, and I have these workouts. All these workouts I showed you I can do without even anything, just with sticks on my leg.
Yeah, you don't even need a kit.
You don't need a kit?
Yeah.
Just do it in my room. So I will warm up definitely, but to do the type of practice I want, I don't have a lot of time. You're right, it's a challenge.
Yeah, awesome. This one's from Kavir. He says, thank you for taking the time out of your clearly busy schedule to share your perspective and wisdom with us. His question is, as somebody who's trying to break into the world of being a working drummer and do session work, what is your advice to help with this? I love talking to session drummers about this, and I would love to hear any tips or essential knowledge you feel we should know to become a working drummer.
Well, Kavir, we're talking about a change in the music business now.
Mm-hmm.
The business model that I was lucky enough to be part of was lucrative income for record labels, where they could invest in bands, build their careers. So it wasn't like shooting. Nowadays people are making their own CDs and they're trying to get it marketed and they're going for one hit. When I was making records with people like John Mellencamp, they didn't want one hit. They wanted, 20, 30 hits. So they wanted us they gave John enough money to pay us so that we could spend a year, if we had to make a record.
Hmm.
And in doing so, you actually throw away crap, and you also are learning and developing and growing as a unit.
Yeah.
A team will always beat an individual. There is no way an individual. Wayne Gretzky couldn't score goals without a team around him. Michael Jordan couldn't be the great basketball player without the defense wondering, is he going to pass? Is he going to dribble? Or is he going to shoot?
Mm-hmm.
So in other words, with the record labels had lots of money. They could invest in a band knowing we want them to get some radio play and progress upward, play in venues to attract people. Next record, bigger venues, more radio play. Next record, bigger venues, more radio play. And with the Mellencamp band, by the time we got to the arenas and were selling out hockey stadiums and soccer, it's not stadiums, arenas, 18, 20,000. We belonged there. We mm-hmm. were set. And all the sessions I did, and I'd stay and maybe do a record for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. Those days are over. So I'm giving you the change in the environment of the music business. There isn't as much money. Therefore, people aren't investing in bands. You're on your own. People are working individually. It's not a group thing as much. So it's a very tough situation now. To break into the session work, I have to tell you, it's not at all what it was. That business is kind of depleted because where they used to fly me in to do one song for Rod Stewart singing, one song for a movie, you know, they aren't doing that anymore. Yeah, that's why I moved to L.A. You had to be in L.A. So now a lot of people are moving to L.A. and Nashville, but now you have too much supply and not enough demand because there isn't enough work to give to all the people that are coming there. But the cream will rise to the top. But there just aren't the budgets. That's why I have a home studio or a professional studio where people send me files because I'm not in the big studios 7 days a week. Those studios are like $2,500 a day. Nobody can afford that.
Yeah.
Unless it's Rod Stewart. I'm on Rod Stewart's record. First two singles of Rod Stewart's record that just came out, I'm on. Well, we went into a professional studio because he can afford it. Major label. John Fogerty, I'm on, did 8 songs on his record. And we were in major studios because they can afford it.
Yeah.
But a lot of records, most of them I'm doing in my studio. So my advice to you is what I tell people is most likely to be in the music business. If you can't support yourself by teaching, doing some sessions and playing live, you're going to have to get a day job to support your love for your music. And I don't mean to discourage you. I'm just telling you the way it is. And just know that that's the way it is, and then you go for it, you know? Mm-hmm. I'm not telling you not to go for it, but the environment has changed quite a bit.
Cool, thank you. That was great. One more question, and did you have another song you wanted to play?
Yeah, I can play another song from Canada.
So one from Canada, like what you're doing from Canada.
Look, I'm in Canada, man. I'm going to play Canadian song.
This one's from Lane. He says, first, he thinks Dromio is great. He's been playing for 40 years, and he's always learning something new. He says, question is, as we get older, the likelihood of injury is greater, and he was unable to play for 18 months due to an elbow injury. And he's wondering, anything you do to stay in shape and keep your playing at your level as time goes on?
That's a big question. Health is the most important thing. You know, me and my wife talk about it all the time because it's a daily thing to think about, you know, how you eat and how to stay healthy. Things are happening all the time to your body. You don't know what's happening until, oh man, that hurts. Mm-hmm. I have injuries all the time. You know, I'll wake up sometimes feeling numb, you know, in my arms. A lot of times, you know, for me, when you have numbness in your hands, it's usually coming from your shoulders and your back. So massage, stretching, certain things. When you lift weights, that's definitely compressing your muscles or doing things to your muscles that will affect nerves and all kinds of things. I realize that. The 7 things for health, in my opinion, are, you know, lifting weights for strength and building your hormone, keeping your hormone levels up. But then to go along with that is stretching. I mean, if I could do yoga in a yoga class every day, I'd love it, but I don't. I don't have time or I don't make the time. So I do stretch. I stretch. So stretching the muscles that you're building up is very important. Third thing is cardio. Cardio is essential. I don't care how hard you play on the drums. There's nothing like massive cardio that pushes your heart rate up. The fourth thing is diet, what you eat. The fifth thing is supplements. Sixth thing is tons of water. You should drink half your body weight. And the seventh thing, which I'm not really good at, but I'm getting better at, or I'm trying to get better at, is sleep. I used to pride myself. 5 hours of sleep, 4 hours of sleep, I'm killing. I'm working more than anybody. But I read some studies that scared me, like, yeah, 5 hours of sleep, you'll be dead when you're like 60 or something. Mm-hmm. So you need sleep, and I'm the worst sleeper in the world. My brain just doesn't stop. But you need to sleep, and you should sleep 7 to 8 hours. Apparently that 8th hour is where your brain memorizes what you did all day. Mm-hmm. And that's probably why I can't even remember my sister's name sometimes. Because I never sleep 8 hours. You know, it's like, I can't remember what I did. Yeah. People say, what have you done lately? I need to sleep 8 hours and then I'll tell you. So as far as injuries, yeah, everybody's body is built different. And so, yeah, these injuries are for real, man. There's, you know, I've got all kinds of stuff. I played sports my whole life, so I got this bad knee there, and I caught a fastball in my hand from my head. Me, Breno, here, I was recording with the pitcher from the Boston Red Sox and went, oh, man, you got to throw to me.
Oh, no.
And you know, when they throw those curveballs, they curve at the last second. It's like, what?
Yeah.
You know, so, you know,
shoot.
It's a battle. So you do the best you can and see, you know, get massages, see, you know, go get advice as much as you can. Go online, find out how to address injuries. Now, if you're doing something wrong on the drum set that created that injury, now you have to change that.
Mm-hmm.
And only you can, unless I saw you play, I can't give you much more advice than what I just told you.
Yeah. Cool. And I do follow you on Facebook, and so I see you have some updates that
yeah.
I've come up with a lot of health stuff,
yeah.
like diet stuff, and I think it's if people want to follow more of that side of you, they
yeah,
can find
that's
you
a
there.
Good idea. Yeah, I have a Twitter site, which is it's Aronoff Official.
Yeah.
And then I have a fan page, Facebook. It's Kenny Aronoff fan page, and then the Kenny Aronoff Facebook, and I have Instagram. I try to post these things, especially Twitter and the two Facebook pages. I'll talk about health. I'll post some things I'm eating and some diets and things. And, yeah, I'm just posting what I'm into and what I hear about. And, yeah.
Cool. You know. For you guys watching, because people are going to watch this on YouTube later. So if you're watching on YouTube, I'll post those links in the info section. So you can just go ahead and click them, and you can like, follow, and whatever else they do online.
Yeah.
So, Matt, thank you so much
awesome,
for
man.
Coming out. It's been such a blast.
Thank you.
You're
thank
welcome
you
to come back. At any time you're in the area, we'd love to have you back.
Well, I come to Vancouver quite often, actually.
Awesome, yeah. I also wanted to thank Yamaha DTX. There's Sean Brown, Mike Sutton, Bob Terry, and Ken Infante, the guys
yeah.
that all do everything here today. They've been so good to us and bringing artists and stuff. So.
And this is our first day of a long month of touring.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For DTX drums, you're going
yep.
all the way into.
We're going to Victoria today,
yeah.
and we'll do a clinic there tomorrow. Then we're in Seattle, Portland, and I do Al Pacino movie, then back to San Jose, off the Bodines, and Bob and I and Mike head down to San Diego, then to the Yamaha headquarters for demonstration, then I go off to Dallas for some gigs, back home for my anniversary,
nice.
And then off to the Midwest, and then we run through Indiana, Chicago, Wisconsin, and yeah.
Everywhere. Cool. Yeah. So for you guys who want to follow Kenny around, you go to kennyarnoff.com, and uncommonstudiosla.com is your studio,
mm-hmm.
and there you can find all of his social feeds and everything like that. And so keep in touch with him, show him a Drumeo welcome. Our Drumeo students are like extremely passionate, so hopefully you get some people
yeah.
on that.
If I don't answer your emails, I apologize. I get like 150 a day. So.
Yeah, I'm sure.
I'm
sure
juggling.
They understand.
I'm juggling producing, recording, you know, yeah. touring, everything.
I'm sure they understand. But cool. We didn't get to all the questions, so I'll save them. Maybe next time you come back, we'll do like a 4 or 5 hour session to get to them.
We should just do the question thing.
Yeah, exactly. Cool.
Awesome. Thank you so much, everybody, and good luck with your drumming and everything else.
Cool.
Thank you.
See you later, man.
Bye.
Thanks so much.
We'll be right back.